This is a production of Cornell University.
Right. Thanks, Adrian, for the beautiful introduction. Today, I'm very happy to be here to present the talk. And my title is The Role of Dreamy One in the Developmental Robustness of Arabidopsis Sepals. So first of all, I would like to give my acknowledgement. I would like to thank the entire Roeder Lab and especially Professor Adrian Roeder, who has provided lots of help through my PhD career, and former graduate student Mian Zhu, whose work laid the foundation of what I'm going to talk about today. And I would also like to thank my thesis committee, including Gaurav and Margaret Carmen. And I would also like to thank Mike for his support, and my collaborators and my neighboring labs for the equipment. And I would finally also like to thank my funding sources for supporting me through my PhD. So today my talk is divided into four parts. I'm first going to give a brief introduction, and then I'm going to talk about my first project, which is how Dreamy One maintains developmental robustness by promoting the translation of key hormone signaling proteins. And then second, I'll talk about my second project, which is how the auxin-CACH1 interaction mediates a trade-off between developmental robustness and morphogenesis rate. And lastly, I will talk briefly about my third project, which is exploring the stochastic gene expression in Arabidopsis, in the auxin signaling in the Arabidopsis flora meristem. So we're all very interested in these beautiful patterns that are able to form in the living world. For example, on the left, this is a Romanesco broccoli, and we know this is an inflorescence composed of many floral meristems. So the arrangement of these floral meristems follow this spiral, this fractal pattern where zooming in on one part of the structure, it actually resembles the whole structure. And similarly, you can zoom in further and then the floral meristems are still arranged in the same way as the whole inflorescence. And in the middle, this is an example of a daisy flower head. And so you know this is an inflorescence composed of many small flowers. And the arrangement of these florets follow these two sets of spirals that go in these opposite directions. And interestingly, the number of these two sets of spirals follow two adjacent numbers in the Fibonacci series, which is fascinating. And the arrangement of these florets is dictated by the precise localization of auxin signaling during the development of this inflorescence. And lastly, on the right, we had this animal example. I'm showing you this peacock tail. And you can see that this is this peacock tail consists of many of these eye spots, which is designed to make the tail beautiful and attractive. So looking further at this tail, we can see that the development of these eye spots is robust because, for example, its number is symmetrical from the left side of the tail to the right side. And that is in contrast to this tail, which has a variable number of spots. The positioning of these eye spots are roughly equal along the tail, and the size of these eye spots are also roughly equal. So what do I mean exactly by developmental robustness, which is what makes this tail beautiful? It means that the same organ between different individuals and also the same type of different organs within the same individual can develop reproducibly going from the same genotype. And that is not influenced by environmental changes or stochastic processes such as stochastic gene expression. And that is in contrast to plasticity, which means that the phenotype develops in response to different environments, and in contrast to variability, which means that the phenotype can be different even in the same environment, and that is influenced by stochastic processes. So in a Roeder lab, we're very interested to know what's the underlying mechanism of developmental robustness. And we're studying that question using the Arabidopsis sepal as the model system. So here on the left, this is an Arabidopsis plant. And you can see that it produces this inflorescence. And on the top of this inflorescence, these are the immature flowers, which are covered on the outside by these green structures that we call sepals. So Arabidopsis sepals develop in a robust way, in that looking at each and every wall-tip bud from the top, you can see that they are always developing four sepals. And the four sepals are always robustly positioned so that they are 90 degrees apart from each other, and they are evenly distributed around the bud. So the robust positioning of these sepals allow us to name them as outer, inner, and the two laterals. So in addition to the robustness in number and position, the sepals are also robust in terms of size. So if you dissect down the four sepals from the same flower, or if you dissect down the sepals from a different flower, you can see that they are always developing to the same mature size. So in wall type, the sepals develop robustly in terms of their number, their position, and their size. In contrast, in the lab, we had this mutant called development-related maple-like 1, also called Dreamy 1. So in this mutant, the sepals develop in a variable way. You can see that some flowers develop four sepals and others develop five sepals, and they are not evenly positioned, so that in some cases on the side, you can see that there are gaps which exposes the inside of the flower, which are the petals, the stamens, and the carpels. And also, the sepals develop into variable sizes. So some sepals are bigger and others are smaller. And so if you look at this flower on the side, you can see that the variable sizes of the sepals leave a gap here on the top that exposes the carpels. So this mutant has been extensively studied in the Roto lab, and we're trying to understand what is the origin of the loss of developmental robustness in the GME1 mutant sepals. Previous work done by a previous graduate student, Mingyuan Zhu, who's now a postdoc at Duke, suggested that the robustness in sepal development in wall type and the variability in the GME1 mutant originates from a very young stage when the sepals have just emerged from the floral meristem. So specifically, in wall-type floral meristems, there are four sepal primordia that initiates, and they initiate in robust positions. So you have outer, inner, and two laterals. So they are positioned evenly and are 90 degrees apart from each other. And the sizes of the sepals are similar, except that the outer sepal primordium is just slightly bigger. In contrast, in the GME1 mutant, if you look at this stage, in this particular bud, there are five sepal primordia that initiates. And these two inner sepal primordia are extremely small compared with the outer sepal primordium. And in addition, you can see the gap here between the two inner sepal primordia that has no sepal coverage. So more importantly, the reason why I say sepal development in wall type is robust is because the developmental program is the same in each and every bud, no matter which one you look at. So all of them have these five sepal primordia developing, and they occur at 90 degrees apart positions, and they are of similar sizes. In contrast, the reason why we say sepal development in GME1 mutant is variable is because each and every bud will be different. So some buds can develop four sepals and others develop five sepals. They occur at irregular positions, and there's a big size difference between them, no matter whether you compare the sepal primordia within the same bud or from a different bud. So we're interested to know what is underlying the loss of developmental robustness during the sepal initiation process in the GME1 mutants. And that leads into my first project, which talks about how GME1 maintains developmental robustness by promoting translation of key hormone signaling proteins. So in order to understand what's wrong in the GME1 mutant, we previously did RNA sequencing. And one of the things that we found was that genes encoding proteins that are involved in translation and ribosome biogenesis and assembly are downregulated in the DREAMY1 mutant compared with wild type. And that is suggesting that maybe something's wrong with ribosome assembly and protein translation. So we tested that in collaboration with Professor Shubin Chen and Lunfei Jia. We found that through polysome profiling, the contents of the ribosome of subunits, the monosome, and the polysome are all drastically reduced in the DREAMY1 mutant compared with wild type. And this is suggesting that indeed there is something wrong with the ribosomes in the DREAMY1 mutant. So it is not able to be able to produce enough ribosomes. So the function of the ribosome is to translate proteins. And that we tested using this technique called pyrimidine labeling. So the signal that you see on the gel would represent the amount of protein translation that is going on during the incubation period. And you can see that the DREAMY1 mutant has much lower signal compared with the wild type samples. And that's indicating that the global protein translation is reduced in the mutant. So a key pathway that controls ribosome biogenesis and protein translation is TOR signaling, called targeted rapamycin signaling. So this is a pathway that integrates many developmental cues to increase the activity of anabolism in the plant, and that includes mRNA translation and ribosome biogenesis. So we hypothesized that maybe this pathway is downregulated in the mutant. And so collaborating with Professor Jacob Bernhardt and Maria Regina Scarpin, we found indeed the TOR signaling activity in the DREAMY1 mutant is downregulated compared with wild type. So now we know that the DREAMY1 mutant has defects in TOR signaling and protein translation. What happens if you downregulate these pathways in wild type? Are you going to be able to reproduce the DREAMY1 mutant phenotype? So that is what I did. When I cultured wild-type buds under mock treatment, you can see that the buds robustly develops 4 sepal primordia, and that is very similar to what I told you before in wild-type. When wild-type buds are cultured under a drug that inhibits TOR activity, you can see that the sepals develop in a variable fashion. So some buds develop 3 sepals and others develop 4. And still others develop 5. And the sepals are not robustly positioned. And also they are of different sizes. And you can get similar phenotypic defects if you culture wild type buds under a drug that inhibits protein translation. So this is agreeing with the hypothesis that inhibition of TOR and protein translation can indeed disrupt the developmental robustness in sepals. So then I asked, what is the molecular mechanism underlying that loss of robustness? And that is related to these two plant hormones, auxin and cytokinin. These are two plant hormones that are very important for development. And this is showing you an example of the initiation of floromeristem, of new buds from the inflorescence. You can see that these two plant hormones are highly concentrated in the places which are going to give rise to the new floromeristems. What about during the process of sepal initiation from the floromeristem? Previous work done by Ming Yuan shows that at the stage of the floromeristem, which is going to give rise to the 4 sepals, you can see that auxin signaling is highly concentrated in these 4 places, corresponding to the 4 sepal primordia, if you culture this a little longer. In contrast, in the DREAMY1 mutant, he saw that auxin signaling is highly diffuse and also weaker, except at the incipient outer sepal position, where it is concentrated. So in other places, it formed these randomly localized patches of cells containing high auxin signaling. He also looked at cytokinin signaling, which is also robustly positioned in wild type. So cytokinin signaling is highly concentrated also in the 4 incipient sepal primordia, in addition to the very center of the bud where it contributes to stem cell maintenance. In contrast, in the GME1 mutant, you can see that cytokine signaling is also highly diffuse and also highly upregulated in the entire periphery of the blood. He further showed that if you disrupt auxin or cytokine signaling genetically, you are getting disruption in the SIPO initiation pattern. That is suggesting that these changes in the level and the patterning of these two plant hormones are actually relevant, actually important to disruption of SIPO initiation robustness in the GME1 mutant. So I hypothesized that the reason why TOR signaling and protein translation can have an effect on SIPO development is by changing these two plant hormones. So that is what I tested. I cultured wild-type buds carrying these two hormone reporters, first of all, under mock treatment. So you can see that under mock treatment, as I told you before, the two hormones are highly concentrated in the four incipient SIPO primordia. In contrast, when these wild-type buds with these two reporters are cultured under translation inhibition or TOR inhibition, you can see that cytokine signaling becomes highly upregulated and also becomes very diffuse. So it loses the robust patterning as in the mock treated. Auxin signaling now becomes weaker, and also, more importantly, it formed these randomly localized patches of cells containing high auxin signaling. So these changes in hormone signaling are very similar to what we observe in the GME1 mutant. And interestingly, if you culture these buds, for example, this one, for three more days, you can see that the SIPOs now emerge at the exact same places which accumulated strong levels of auxin signaling. And these are at random places in contrast to the mock treated where the SIPOs are always emerging at the same place. So these results indicate that indeed it is a disruption of auxin and cytokine signaling that is causing this loss of robustness in SIPO initiation under TOR and translation inhibition. So then how does inhibition of TOR and translation affect these plant hormones? The first thing we know is that if you culture wild-type buds under exogenous cytokinin, so you're supplying it with a lot of cytokinin, you're causing auxin signaling to form these randomly localized auxin maxima, which doesn't happen under the mock treatment. So we think that the reason why auxin signaling becomes variable under TOR and translation inhibition is because of an increase and also more diffuse cytokinin signaling. So then how does cytokinin signaling becomes highly upregulated and also more diffuse? So if you look at the cytokinin signaling pathway, you can see that it is not a linear pathway, but it also contains these negative feedbacks. So when cytokinin is perceived by these histidine kinases, the histidine kinases transfer the phosphate group to the rhodopsin histidine phosphatases. These HP proteins then move into the nucleus and transfers the phosphate group further to the type B response regulators, which mediates the downstream cytokine responsive gene expression. So this pathway isn't linear because of the presence of these negative regulators. So these type A response regulators are the ones that are produced in response to cytokine signaling, and its function is to absorb a phosphate group from the HP proteins, but does not trigger the downstream transcriptional response. So that way it dampens the signal. Similarly, you have the HP6 protein, which is a pseudohistidine phosphatase, and that absorbs the phosphate group from the HK proteins, but does not transfer that further to the response regulators. So we think that under TOR and the translation inhibition, because the ability of the plant to produce proteins is reduced, when cytokinin signaling becomes activated, the plant is no longer able to rapidly produce these dampening proteins to decrease the signal. So therefore, the cytokinin signaling becomes highly upregulated. So I tested that hypothesis by, first of all, observing the effect of translation and mTOR inhibition on the level of the HP6 protein. So as you can see, under mock treatment, HP6 protein is highly accumulated in these four regions corresponding to the four incipient CPO primordia. Under translation and mTOR inhibition, the level of the HP6 protein drastically reduces. I then tested the type A response regulators. So the most highly expressed one is the ARR7. So I used the LAMA-TAG system, which is used to examine the level of proteins that are rapidly degraded. And so in this system, basically the presence of the nuclear signal indicates the presence of this protein, and the lack of nuclear signal and the presence of the cytoplasmic signal indicates a reduced level of this protein. So using this system, I found that in the mock treated, there is a lot of nuclear signal, whereas under translation or mTOR inhibition, there's a decrease in the nuclear signal and an increase in the cytoplasmic signal surrounding the nucleus. That is suggesting, indeed, there is a decrease in the level of the ARR7 protein when the plant is under translation and mTOR inhibition. So I also tested a few positive regulators in cytokinin signaling, and their level either doesn't decrease or decrease very little in response to these treatments. And so finally, if you hypothesize that the reason why developmental robustness is disrupted is because the plant is no longer able to produce these proteins, then what happens if you mutate them? So when you mutate the type A response regulators in this higher order mutant, I saw a reduction in the robustness of SIPO size. So this one, this inner SIPO, becomes smaller compared with the outer SIPO. And when you mutate the HP6 protein, I found that the SIPOs now develop in a more variable fashion. So in this particular bud, there are these five SIPO primordia, and some are extremely small compared with the others, and also the position is disrupted as well. So all these data agrees with our hypothesis that under translation inhibition, the plant is no longer able to quickly synthesize these dampening proteins, and therefore cytokinin signaling is upregulated. So that was the end of my first part. A brief summary is that how the GME1 protein promotes development robustness of SIPOs is that it can maintain a normal level of mTOR signaling and protein translation. Therefore, the plant is able to produce these dampening proteins, and that decreases the level of cytokinin signaling. And decreased level of cytokinin signaling promotes the robustness in auxin signaling, which underlies robust SIPO initiation from the polymeric stem. So moving on to my second part, it is regarding how the auxin-COX-1 interplay mediates a trade-off between developmental robustness and morphogenesis rate. So back to the question of what contributes to the loss of developmental robustness in the GME1 mutant SIPOs. In the same RNA sequencing, where I found a downregulation in genes encoding ribosomal proteins, I also found an upregulation in the expression of this gene called COX-1 in the GME1 mutant. So COX-1 is a boundary-specific transcription factor. As you can see, it is highly expressed in this boundary between the two cotyledons in this developing seed. And so I hypothesized that maybe the upregulation of COX-1 in the GME1 mutant is the cause of the loss of developmental robustness in the mutant. So I tested that by crossing the GME1 mutant with the COX-1 mutant. So The GME1 mutant, as I told you before, develop a range of 3 to 5 sepals. In this case, there are 5, and they are not correctly positioned, and there is also a big size difference. In contrast, when you mutate CUC1, in the GME1 CUC1 double mutant, you're restoring the robustness in terms of sepal primordium number and position. So all buds develop 4 sepals at exact the same positions as in wild type. Although the size difference is still there. On the other hand, what happens if you overexpress CUC1 in wild type? Well, if you overexpress CUC1, you can see that the sepals now develop in a variable way. So that indicates that the upregulation of CUC1 is both necessary and also sufficient to disrupt the developmental robustness in the sepals. And I said that auxin signaling is very important for sepal development. So I looked at auxin signaling in the GME1 mutants. As I told you before, auxin signaling is form these diffuse bands in addition to this additional auxin maxima. Okay, so auxin signaling is accumulating in these diffuse bands in the GME1 mutant, in addition to these incorrectly positioned auxin maxima. But when you mutate CUC1, you can see that the auxin signaling now form these 4 auxin maxima at correct places, so restoring robustness. On the other hand, in contrast to wild type, which form these 4 auxin maxima, when you overexpress CUC1, there is additional auxin maxima forming. So this indicates that the upregulation of CUC1 can disrupt robustness in auxin signaling, which underlies the loss of robustness in sepal initiation. So then how does it happen? How does CUC1 disrupt auxin signaling patterns? In order to understand that question, we first need to know what is the normal function of CUC1 in wild type? What does it do? So in a stage when the floral meristem accumulates these 4 auxin maxima, the CUC1 protein is accumulated highly in its boundaries that separates the auxin maxima from the rest of the bud. So what it does in the boundary is that it increases the convergence of pin polarity. So auxin is a hormone that is produced in the entire epidermis of the bud, and how it gets to these 4 auxin maxima is through the action of the PIN1. So PIN1 is polarly localized, which means that it is highly accumulated in one part of the cell, but not the other. The role of PIN1 is to transport auxin from one cell to another, which is up the concentration gradient. So at the tissue level, this emergently creates these patches of cells with high auxin signaling, which attracts the polarity of PIN1 towards them. And these are these auxin maxima, which underlies the initiation of the sepals. So in a wild-type bud carrying this PIN1 GFP reporter, you can see that the polarity of the PIN1 all points to these 2 central cells, which is the auxin maxima. On the other hand, when you lose CUC1, the polarity pattern of the PIN1 protein is less clear, although some cells are still polar. So CUC1 promotes the convergence of pin polarity, and as a result, auxin maxima is stronger in wild type compared with in the CUC1 single mutant. And because auxin is such an important hormone to organ development, you can see that in wild type, the sepals emerge from the floral meristem faster compared with a CUC1 mutant bud of a similar stage. So the function of CUC1 in wild type is that it increases the polar auxin transport and it increases the intensity of auxin maxima, which helps the rapid initiation of the sepals from the floral meristem. And that is actually crucial because the SIPO functions to protect the floral meristem. So it would want to, it would want the sepals to emerge from the floral meristem quicker for better protection. So now we know the function of COX-1 in wild type. How about in the GME1 mutant? How does it disrupt the developmental robustness of the GME1 mutant bud? So in terms of auxin signaling, I told you before that auxin signaling form these elongated bands, these diffuse bands, which then localize to these incorrectly positioned auxin maxima. And the COX-1 protein is accumulated surrounding these auxin maxima. What it does there is that it amplifies them. So this is a light imaging of the GME1 mutant bud going from the left to the right, the same bud that is live imaged two times. And you can see that in the beginning, this GME1 mutant bud accumulates these noise in auxin signaling. So some cells just stochastically have higher auxin signaling compared with the other cells. And that is in contrast to wild type, where although there is a little bit of noise, the auxin patterning is largely robust, robustly concentrated in its three auxin maxima. And if you light image the GME1 mutant bud over time, you can see that the auxin noise gradually gets amplified. So in the end, this noise patch is stabilized to become these two cells with strong auxin signaling, which is going to give rise to a sepal that is not correctly positioned. This is in contrast to wild type, where in the end of the live imaging series, it formed these four auxin maxima. In contrast, when you don't have the COX-1 gene, although you still have this auxin signaling noise, over time, it is gradually going to disappear. So when the noise dissipates, the correctly positioned auxin maxima can form in a similar way as in wild type. So in the GME1 mutants, the role of COX-1 is that it can accumulate surrounding the noisy auxin patches and amplify them so that they eventually become an auxin maxima that is not correctly positioned. I hypothesize that that happens through the same mechanism in which the COX-1 gene amplifies robustly positioned auxin maxima to increase their intensity in wild type. And that mechanism is by increasing the polarity of the pin proteins. So I wanted to test whether the same mechanism is sufficient to explain what happens in wild type as well as in the GME1 mutant. And therefore, I implemented a computational model. So I modeled the floral meristem development starting with a two-dimensional disk of cells, which is allowed to grow and divide, and the pattern is allowed to form. So these green spots represent auxin signaling, and then the blue color represents the presence of the COX-1 protein, which increases the polarity of PIN1. So under the low noise regime of the model, where I introduced a low level of stochasticity in terms of auxin production, I found that when you increase pin polarity, the auxin maxima pattern forms more quickly, and also it is more concentrated compared with when you reduce pin polarity. So this is very similar to what we observe in real wild type versus the COX-1 mutant buds. On the other hand, when you model the bud under the high noise regime, where I introduce a lot of stochasticity in terms of auxin production rate, both within the same cell over time and also between neighboring cells. When you increase pin polarity, you can see that there is noise amplification. So this GME1 mutant bud simulation here has a lot of auxin noise, especially here in these two cells. These two cells are gradually being amplified into this little patch of auxin maxima in the end, which doesn't occur in wild type. When you reduce pin polarity, however, although in the beginning, auxin signaling is very diffuse and very noisy, In the end, you're going to end up with four auxin maxima in a simulation. So this matches our observation for the GME1 mutant versus the GME1 KAAG1 double mutant buds. So from the modeling, I concluded that an increase in pin polarity is sufficient to explain what we observe in wall type condition where it increases the intensity of auxin maxima, and also in the GME1 mutant case where it amplifies the sporadic auxin noise. So that's the end of my second part, and I hope to briefly summary. So under conditions that promote a low level of auxin noise, such as the presence of the GME1 gene, which maintains a proper level of cytokinin signaling, having KAAG1 is beneficial because it increases the intensity of auxin signaling and promotes the fast initiation of the sepals from the floral meristem. On the other hand, under conditions that promote a high level of auxin noise, such as when GME1 mutant is mutated or when translation and TOR signaling is inhibited, having KAAG1 can actually stabilize the auxin noise to become auxin maxima and sepals that are not correctly positioned. And therefore, having KAAG1 is actually detrimental. In this case, not having the KAAG1 protein is beneficial because it now allows the sporadic noise to disappear and give the bud enough time for the correct pattern to form. So this highlights that during development, there might be a trade-off between speed and robustness. So having KAAG1 increases the speed of sepal initiation, but disrupts its robustness against a high level of auxin noise. And an interesting prediction from the model is that if you change growth rate, actually, it can affect the final patterning outcome. So going from the same starting template, this was the growth rate that I was using on my previous slides. If you increase growth rate, you can see that you're actually increasing the variability in the final pattern and disrupt robustness, even in wall type. So wall type now formed additional auxin maxima. If you reduce growth rate, on the other hand, even the GME1 mutants now form four auxin maxima robustly in the simulation. If you look at this further, initially, there is actually a high level of auxin noise, especially in these two cells. And over time, these two cells try to form an auxin maxima, but then they couldn't because the bud grows too slowly. And they get actually absorbed by the nearby auxin maxima. So in the end, there are four. So I validated this model prediction using real buds. So real GME1 buds, and this is live image through time, going from left to right. On the bottom, this is the normal growth condition where there is 1% sucrose and the buds grow really fast. I try to decrease growth rate using a low level, actually no sucrose, and that is the top panel. So you can see that under the fast growth regime, this GME1 mutant bud shows noise stabilization over time so that it formed these additional auxin maxima. In contrast, when the GME1 mutant bud is growing under no sucrose, although initially there is noise, over time the noise gradually dissipates. So in the end, there are these four auxin maxima that form. So this matches our model, and this indicates again, during development, there is a trade-off between morphogenesis speed and robustness. So when you reduce the speed, it actually promotes the robustness of patterning. So finally, I would like to spend just a few minutes talking about my third project, which is exploring the stochastic gene expression in auxin signaling in the floral meristem. So I told you before that in wall-type buds, the auxin signaling accumulates robustly in its four places, which are going to give rise to the four sepals. But if you look earlier, in stage one, when the floral meristem have just emerged from the inflorescence meristem, or in early stage two, when the floral meristem have just become separated from the inflorescence meristem by a boundary. In these stages, there is actually stochasticity in auxin signaling. So for example, in this particular bud, there is this strain of cells which has strong auxin signaling, and that is a different pattern in a different bud. So in this bud, there are these three patches of cells with high auxin signaling. So if you look at a different bud, it's gonna be a different pattern. So this bud has this patch with strong auxin signaling. As the bud moves towards late stage two, the pattern gradually becomes canalized into these four auxin maxima. So the presence of noise in stage one and early stage two is a very interesting phenomenon. And I asked, what is the origin of this noise? So in literature, noise has been attributed to two sources. There is extrinsic and there is intrinsic. So extrinsic noise represents the different signals that different cells receive. For example, different cells may have different auxin concentrations. So maybe that is what's causing the stochasticity in auxin signaling. And secondly, there is intrinsic noise, which represents, for example, transcriptional bursts and the different chromatin state differences between different cells. So extrinsic versus intrinsic noise can be distinguished using a dual reporter system. So for example, in our case, I have two DR5 reporters driven by the same promoter, and I have two different fluorophores. So I have venous, which is nuclear localized, and I have RFP, which is cytoplasmic localized. So if the noise is an extrinsic noise, you would expect that some cells maybe has high levels of auxin, and therefore it can trigger high levels of expression of both the nuclear marker and the cytoplasmic marker. Cells that receive a low auxin level or no auxin level would show a very reduced expression of both markers at the same time. On the other hand, if the noise is intrinsic, you would expect that the two reporters behave independently. So some cells would randomly trigger the expression of one of the reporters, but not the other, and vice versa. So using this dual reporter system, I tested whether the noise I observe is intrinsic versus extrinsic. You can see that in stage one and early stage two, there are these cells which only express one of the markers, but not the other. So these three cells express only the green marker, but not the red. And these cells, for example, expresses only the red, but not the green. So that indicates that the source of this noise in wall-type buds in stage one and early stage two is intrinsic. Over time, towards late stage two, you can see that both markers now highly expresses in the four incipient sepal primordia, and that is possibly guided by an extrinsic cue, which is auxin accumulation in these four places. So I also tested that idea using a different marker. So the DR5 marker that I showed you earlier represents the auxin responsive gene expression that is downstream of auxin signaling. But if you look at a different marker, which is R2D2, this would reflect the accumulation of auxin. So this marker is robust because of the pattern that you see, the degradation of the green signal, which represents auxin concentration, is always the same if you look at different buds at the same stage. For example, here in the beginning, it is highly concentrated in the cryptic bract region, which is a bract that doesn't grow out in Arabidopsis. And later you have the accumulation of auxin in these two incipient lateral sepal positions. Later, you have accumulation of auxin in these in the outer and inner sepal position in addition to the lateral sepals. So this pattern is robust and not noisy, in contrast to the DR5, which is noisy. This is agreeing with the idea that the source of noise that we observe in stage one and early stage two is because of intrinsic noise, such as transcriptional bursts. In contrast, I also look at GME1 and it looks like noise in auxin signaling in the GME1 mutant, but is primarily extrinsic. So you can see in this dual reporter system that there are these patches of cells containing high levels of both markers at the same time. So even in the end, at late stage two, when sepals are about to emerge, there are these two patches of cells with high expression of both markers in the incipient abaxial outer sepal position. And that is going to, that is likely going to give rise to two outer sepals. So in agreement to that observation, I found that in contrast to wall type, where the R2D2 reporter is robustly localized in these four incipient sepals, I found that in the GME1 mutant, there are actually additional auxin maxima that is not correctly localized in GME1. So these two patches of cells have high levels of auxin accumulation, and that is in addition to the regular outer and inner sepal primordia. So overall, these results show that during stage one and early stage two, there is a high level of intrinsic noise in wall-type buds, which gradually canalizes to the four auxin maxima as auxin starts to accumulate in these four places. In contrast, in the GME1 mutant, there is a lot of extrinsic noise in stage one and early stage two, and that is likely guided by incorrect places of auxin accumulation. So that is the end of my talk, and I would like to briefly summarize the three aspects. In my first project, I showed that the GME1 mutant maintains developmental robustness by promoting the translation of key proteins that function to dampen cytokinin signaling, which maintains robust positioning of auxin maxima and sepals. And in my second project, I've shown that the interplay between auxin and CACH1 mediates a trade-off between morphogenesis speed and robustness. So that when you have CACH1, you increase the speed, but you disrupt the robustness against high levels of auxin noise. And lastly, in wall-type buds, in early stage one and stage two, the intrinsic noise in auxin signaling triggers the stochastic expression of DR5. And that is gradually canalized towards late stage two so that eventually it formed these four auxin maxima, which is guided by auxin accumulation in these places. And that is all. Thank you.
Great talk. My question is, so why does it seem like the outer sepal is the most robust? It always seems like it sort of keeps its relative position. It's always the largest, it seems like, from the images you've shown. Do you know why that might be?
Yes, that is a good question. I think if you look at auxin signaling, in most cases, you have a robustly positioned and concentrated auxin maxima in the incipient outer sepal position. And how does that happen, right? I think it might be related to the interaction between the floral meristem and the cryptic bract, because normally in wall-type, there's a cryptic bract which accumulates auxin, and that doesn't happen a lot in the GME1 mutant. So you may think that maybe the auxin there is being absorbed to form that auxin maxima. And that also may guide the positioning of the outer sepal so that it is more robust compared with the outer sepals.
That was great. You did a great job explaining that. I think the mechanisms of how the signaling pathways are affected in the mutant is clear, but what do you think the protein is doing. Do you think it's part of the many components of the TOR network, or is it a ribosome? What is this protein?
Yeah, so that is a very good question. And also that's a question that I get a lot. And so this protein encodes a MAPE transcription factor. So it has a MAPE domain, but on the other hand, the MAPE domain is the same as the scent domain. So the scent domain should be part of a chromatin remodeler complex. So either way it should bind DNA, right? But we did ChIP-seq and we didn't detect any specific peaks. So we saw like just genomic background, and we did cut and run, which is a more sensitive version of ChIP-seq. And also we didn't detect any peaks. So now at this point, we don't know whether it binds to DNA. On the other hand, there's evidence showing that GME1 mutant interacts with other proteins. So so one of them is pontin. So the pontin reptin complex is a complex that does many things, and one of them is pore assembly. So you may think that maybe the GME1 mutant participates in such a complex that helps the assembly of the TOR complex, which activates TOR activity. On the other hand, it may also still be a chromatin remodeler, so maybe it participates in the chromatin remodeler complex. So evidence for that is that GME1 is highly co-expressed with components of the Swi-SNF chromatin remodeler complex. And also the GME1 mutant paralog is found to interact at a protein level with the with BRAHMA and also with SWI3C, so two components of that complex. So maybe it can also be a chromatin remodeler. And so these are a few possibilities.
For your growth rate model for constraining the number of auxin maxima, how do you separate growth rate from just overall organ size? So for example, in like faciated meristems, you get lots of extra organs, but it's likely due to size rather than like cell.
Yeah, that is a very good question. So in my model, when I show the model, so these are all floral meristems that that develop for the same amount of time going from the starting template, right? So, but actually for these ones, if you look at the time point when they have roughly the same cell as these simulations, these are also more variable. And also these, if you allow them to develop a little for a little longer, these are still more robust than this case. Yeah.
This has been a production of Cornell University on the web at cornell.edu.